Hi, it's Ashley from Sweet Dreams Bake Shop, and today we're going to be making a Stitch baby shower cake. Now, the baby shower elements of this are very, very subtle, so really, if you just want to create a Stitch cake, then this is the tutorial for you. Today, I am making a 6-inch and 4-inch tiered cake, so this is the 4-inch here. I'm going to slow things down just a little bit. I'm going to level this off. This is my favorite chocolate cake recipe, and I am going to use my Italian meringue buttercream as usual, and I'm being pretty generous with the way that I fill this. Notice how I keep the spatula nice and flat, and then I move the cake turntable around. That way, I ensure that everything stays nice and flat, and as I go along, trying to keep things nice and level. We are going to be covering this in fondant. So one of the things that I'm really focusing on is making sure that I get this nice and smooth. It doesn't have to be perfect, but it does need to have a smooth surface so that when we put that fondant on, we still get edges, but we have everything smooth without any lines showing through. One of the things I really struggled with in the beginning with cake decorating was having my tiers kind of slipping and sliding on me. So if you are noticing that as you're trying to crumb coat things, they're sliding around, just place it into the fridge and then go ahead and finish crumb coating it. Anytime you have an issue with your buttercream, the fridge is your best friend so that you can work more easily with it later on. And also be sure to re-whip all of your buttercreams before you apply them. I kept that in the fridge for about 20 minutes or so, just so it solidifies up a bit. Italian meringue buttercream does not form a crust, so I will be able to place this fondant on directly. If you're using American buttercream, you will have a crust that forms, so you will want to put some shortening on there so that it adheres to the fondant. You'll notice that I don't use any special rolling pin techniques or anything to get this fondant on there. I am very fearless, and I just pick up that fondant and place it right on. This is especially easy if you're working with a smaller cake, like a 6-inch here. Now, I'm leaving a lot of this part in because I know the other day some people talked about how they were getting folding at the bottom of their cakes when they use this technique. So as I'm showing you what to do here, what's really happening is I'm pulling out that bottom to make it nice and flat first, and then I'm using my hand to adhere that fondant to the side of the cake. And what's actually happening is the fondant is actually stretching out a little bit. So it is thinning out the fondant, which means that when you actually roll this fondant out, don't make it too thin, or else you're going to have difficulty when you do this part. You'll get a lot of tearing going on. Now I'm using a pastry cutter just to get rid of all the excess. I find it a lot easier to do that than use an X-Acto knife. This board is going to be showing, so I do want to clean that board off. I find the best way to do that, especially if you're using fondant, is to steam the board and then just wipe everything clean, or you can just take a little spatula like I did and take off that excess. I'm also making sure to smooth everything out, keeping that top nice and flat. The mom-to-be's favorite color is purple, so I kind of want to do a light-ish purple. Now, I do notice that with Chef Master food coloring, it is a little bit blue, so I'm adding in that pink there just to warm it up just a little bit. Now, if I were to have any choice of fondant coloring available to me, I would definitely use fondant, which I just discovered last week when I was making my princess cake. And it basically dyes your fondant and doesn't cause it to be sticky and doesn't compromise the texture at all. Now we're going to work on stacking this cake. So I am going to leave a nice big space in the front just in case I want to put other things on top of this cake. Now, I used to always cut my boards down to size instead of purchasing the correct sizes because I just didn't want to buy more than one size. But actually, this hurt me in the long run because I found that the results just weren't that great. So when you're putting in those supports, you want to make sure that everything is nice and even. And this goes back to why I think you should purchase the correct size board instead of trying to cut it. It's very, very difficult to cut a perfect circle. So making sure that everything here is really nice and perfect is going to lend to the best stacking that you can do. And you don't want anything toppling over. So you'll notice I use that wooden dowel in there. Reason being is that has a point at the bottom of it, which I can stick right into the cardboard of this cake board, and it's all going to stay together. And this is super, super stable. One last tip about stacking your fondant cakes. Some people do like to wait until they're completely dry and then stack them. I find that that always produces cracks. So I really like to stack my fondant cakes right away. For this whole tutorial, I'm pretty much going to be steaming my cake and then adding on all of these cutout little details. I'm doing a lot of leaves here, And I'm also using this fondant mold. Now, this fondant mold is pretty easy to work with. However, I will say that you really have to punch in your fondant. And when you're trying to lift that out and get out all the excess, you don't want to use an X-Acto knife. You do want to make sure that you use some sort of spatula or something that doesn't have a sharp edge, or else you're going to cut into your mold. Now, when you're cutting off the excess, sometimes the fondant can lift out. So you do need to be careful about the way that you cut off that excess to prevent anything from lifting. I'm just adding on a bunch of really simple floral details, and I'm using all one mat to pretty much do this. So if you're making a cake like this and you need to add a lot of different things, I highly suggest that you invest in a one-stop shop type of deal, unless you have a huge collection already. Now, this cake is pretty simple in structure and in detail. I think the hardest part about this is actually creating the little stitch character on top. So I'm not being super, super close with the color or anything. I am just using a blue, and that was a sky type blue. Now, what I'm using here is a powder, which is a Tylose powder, that's going to dry my fondant way faster. So whenever I'm making fondant characters, I tend to use this in place of the cornstarch so that everything solidifies quickly. Now, a little warning with this, if you're not good at working fast, I wouldn't use too much of this. I'm used to working really fast now, so I can use quite a bit so that it hardens. But if you're working slow, you might get a lot of cracks. Now, I don't want Stitch's eyes to bug out too much, so I'm just indenting that, kind of the shape of your fingers. For the body portion, I'm combining two sets of blue. Reason being is the bottom is supposed to be kind of like a baby's diaper. It does get covered up quite a bit, but it peeks out just enough. For the eye portion, we're going to fill that in with kind of like an almond shape with a flat side on one part. And then we're going to do that for both sides. For some reason, I noticed myself using my left hand quite a bit, which I never really noticed before because I'm right-handed, but it seems like I'm switching from side to side. Then to add on that nose is really easy. I'm just using a little bit of black fondant and I'm keeping it fairly rounded, but Stitch does have a slight triangular edge to it. Then I'm going to add a little black portion to his eye and a little white glint. If ever you feel your character's eyes don't look friendly enough, just add that little white glint and it will probably fix it. Now, whenever I'm making characters that don't have to be in a certain position, I always kind of use this particular structure, which is what I like to call the teddy bear structure, because it's basically what a teddy bear would look like as well. Reason being is because you can cover it up with lots of detail and you can kind of make it look like whatever. You'll also notice that I did choose to make Stitch's ears hanging down. I just think he looks a little bit cuter like that, but you could definitely do that with the ears sticking up, and with the Tylose powder, they will stick up right away. Now, after making Stitch look a little bit more babyish, I'm also adding on this little clothesline made out of leaves, and I just hand cut all of these different little pieces of clothing. I really like doing this with baby shower cakes. I don't always like to do the traditional baby shower cake, and this particular person really, really wanted a Lilo and Stitch theme, so I decided to just kind of give a nod to some of those baby elements. Now, to make those flowers really pop, I'm just airbrushing a little bit of orange in the center of each flower. At the last minute, I decided it needed a little something extra, so I put that little fake flower at the bottom. Now let's get into the pricing of this cake. Now this is obviously very highly customized, so I would only do it as a custom order for $295 Canadian. There's a lot of things going on this cake, but what's really bringing up that price is those little fondant characters and fondant details. Thanks so much for watching, guys. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe so you can be part of the Sweetie fam. Right now, I'm uploading weekly tutorials, so make sure you hit that notification bell so you know when I upload. Also, be sure to comment, request, or ask a question. I love hearing from you guys. Bye!